YouTube, Iceman Baldy here. And the first thing I want to do is tell you that I have decided on a new audio solution. It's a Rode Video Micro microphone that I have attached to my GoPro Hero 5 with the use of an aluminum hot shoe casing that I found online for about $18. So I've got that Rode microphone attached to a hot shoe setting on the housing, and then I'm using the 3-in-1 GoPro handle with the tripod on the bottom to situate the entire device. So it's a fairly portable solution. It's a bit modular. The whole setup is about 1.5 feet tall once it's all set to go. I've got the, I think they call it a cat skin microphone cover on, although I'm not outside, but hopefully you can tell a big difference in the audio quality. The test that I did yesterday with the Rode, and I kept calling it Rodey, is Rode Smart Lav connected to my iPhone was not that impressive. I didn't think that the sound quality with the GoPro Hero 5 in the Karma grip was all that different than having the Smart Lav used as an external audio source while also using that Karma grip. So again, I was less than satisfied. Hopefully the quality here is much, much better. I've seen this online as a better solution overall, so I thought I'd give it a try. Today we're talking about Polaroid cameras, one of my many obsessions. So a couple years ago, my wife got me a foldable Polaroid camera as a Christmas gift. This is not the camera she got me. It was one like this. This was the second camera that I bought because it then became an addiction. I've got this one attached to a tripod, but let's take it apart. This camera uses an integral film that was developed by Polaroid. It was first produced in the early 70s, 1972 through probably 78 or so, and it's still a very stylish camera, but is known for the square format with the white border on the bottom that has kind of been the standard for digital formats like Instagram in terms of that look. Glass element, I believe it's got an F8 shutter. You can get close up with this thing and get some really creative shots, but the film is fairly unpredictable. And in fact, the original film is no longer in production, but a company called The Impossible Project in the late 80s bought one of the last Polaroid factories and began remaking the chemistry for the film. And so this is the black and white version of the film that goes in the SX70 style cameras, which are the foldable cameras. I've also got a Polaroid Spectra, which was one of the cameras that was produced a little bit later. This is probably 1988 or so, a wider format camera. It uses this Polaroid Spectra film, but you get a little more of a landscape view or a longer portrait view. Again, integral film. Some better electronics here, a little more compact than the camera that is probably one of the more popular versions of the Polaroid, the 660 box cameras. This is a Polaroid 660 SE. It's probably 1981 vintage, and it uses a 600 style film that's different than the SX70, also different than the Spectra film. A little more sensitive to light and useful in darker environments. Faster shutter speed in many cases, but a much more box style camera. Not as slim and sleek as the original SX70. And so the Spectra was trying to get back to something in a little sleeker form factor with a bigger film print, but they all have different uses. The SX70 Sonar was a camera It has a sonar attachment. Looks a lot like the original SX-70, aside from this piece that's attached. This is a sonar-based autofocus. So when you push the button, a sound wave goes out, is reflected back to the camera, and then the camera processor judges the distance and moves the lens accordingly to provide very, very sharp focus. Works in darkness, so unlike digital cameras where you've got that illumination light that comes on in the dark to kind of give a sense of focus, this is based completely on sound and is very, very accurate even now. Because this design was so popular, the Polaroid 690 was kind of a Japanese version of the original Polaroid. They bought the rights to use it and the patents and so forth, and developed a camera that has got much more up-to-date electronics. This is like a 1998 camera. You get the folding style, you get the benefit of the sonar autofocus, you also get an integrated flash. This is kind of my go-to when I want kind of an all-purpose, gotta get the shot camera in almost any kind of environment. It also uses the 600 based film, which, as I said, is a little more light sensitive than the original SX 70 style film, or the film that Polar or the Impossible Project makes for the SX 70, but a really good camera. This device that you saw attached to the camera that I started with on the tripod is a remote. So it just plugs into the side of the camera. I can put this on a tripod or leave it someplace standing, and you just push this little button and it fires off the shutter, and now the film is released. So that comes in handy when I want very, very tack sharp shots. I'm using a tripod, or I don't want to be as close to the camera to get a shot. The last camera in my collection of cameras, and I've got several more. I've got two of these 660 style cameras. I've got two Spectras. I've got another SX-70. I've got two other SX-70 style cameras where the electronics have been completely refurbished, and they even offer some manual capability in terms of controlling the shutter speed, even down to the bulb or a time mode. So another two cameras, but this is my most recent one. This is the Impossible I-1. Very stylish camera, kind of along the lines of the box style with a fairly avant-garde design. It uses a top-mounted focusing system optical that's fairly manual. I'm not crazy about it, but it works, and it's also detachable. So in the event that Impossible wants to provide some other attachments that use the space, they can do that. There have been none released as of yet, but we'll see what happens. I can't seem to get that back on. Uses a special film, the Impossible I-Type film. And what's nice about this camera is where the original Polaroid cameras don't have any battery power, and the battery is built inside the film, and so the film is what powers the camera. It's a little more expensive because you've got to buy film and the battery that's in the film. As it stands, these packs of film go for about $24-$25 a package. These aren't much cheaper, but because this camera has its own battery built in and can power the film tends to be a little bit cheaper. I can also use expired film where the batteries in the Impossible film, or if you can find the original Polaroid film, might have died. This camera will still power the film. And so this film is probably more like $20 or so. Still not cheap. You only get 8 exposures per film pack. So you're spending, an average $2 or so, or $3 for every click of the shutter button. So you have to be very discriminating about what you're shooting. The other thing I like about this camera is it's got a Bluetooth app, so you can use your phone to do some manual shooting, remote shooting, double exposure, some creative arts effects, and that's really nice. The one drawback about this camera so far that I really dislike is the battery doesn't really hold a charge over a long time period. So once you charge it and you're using it, you're good to go. You can probably shoot, I don't know, maybe 10 packs of film or more. But if you let it sit for a while on a shelf or you're just not using it, the battery drains pretty quickly. And then when you want to go use it, you don't have any power and you're probably going to have to recharge it. So that kind of kills any instantaneous shots that that you might want to take. So there you have it. That's my a brief look at my arsenal of Polaroid cameras. I shoot digital as well, but I found that because digital cameras have gotten so good, the processors are so nice, some of the automated features are fun, but take some of the unpredictability out of shooting film and make people get lazy about composition and getting it right in camera. With the nuances and the unpredictable nature of both the cameras and the film, Polaroid shooting becomes more of an art form. And that kind of takes me back to the days where you really had to take your time, try to get it right, and even when you didn't quite get it right, some of your mistakes wound up being some of your best surprises. So that's it for today's video. Hope you enjoyed this review of some old-fashioned Polaroid cameras, and that's it. Iceman out.